Hello again, ICC. This is part two of the devotional or midday connect that I started last time that I spoke with you. We talked about the Amalekites and how they, when they attacked the Israelites as they were fleeing, they would always attack the weak and the vulnerable, the people that straggle or laid behind a little bit. And Richard Agler, the rabbi, a friend of mine, had talked about how this was like the coronavirus is they're the Amalekites of today. And then I commented about what a punk I thought the devil was for attacking the weak and the vulnerable, and that seems to be what he always does. And then it challenged each of us with the Romans chapter 12, verse 15 and 16, where it says, rejoice with those who rejoice and to mourn with those who mourn. And then it goes on, it says, live in harmony with one another. Don't be proud, be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. And I get up every morning, and one of the just physical or spiritual disciplines that I have is just to spend some time reading some devotionals. One of my favorite authors is a guy named Philip Yancey. He's been around a long time and has written a great book dealing with when God doesn't make sense. He came, this is an article that he did, appeared actually in Christianity Today, but it's just 2 weeks after the shooting at Virginia Tech, Philip Yancey spoke to the student body, and here's part of what he had to say. So I'm just going to read this, and this let this stand as our midday connect today. To the students at Virginia Tech, I wish I could say that the pain you feel will disappear, vanish, never return. Yet what happened on April 16, 2007 will stay with you forever. You're a different person because of that day, because of one troubled young man's actions. You are a different person. So I can't say what I want to say, that this too shall pass. Instead, I point to the pain you feel and will continue to feel as a sign of life and love. I'm wearing a neck brace because I broke my neck in an auto accident. As I lay strapped to a bodyboard for the first few hours, they refused to give me any pain medication because they needed my response. The doctor kept probing, moving my limbs, asking, does this hurt? Do you feel that? The correct answer, the answer both he and I desperately wanted was, yes, it hurts. I can feel it. Each sensation gave proof that my spinal cord had not been severed. Pain offered proof of life, of connection, a sign that my body remained whole. In grief, love and pain converge. The young man, Joe, felt no grief as he gunned down your classmates because he felt no love for them. You feel that grief because you did have a connection. Those who died belong to a body for which you belong. When that body suffers, you suffer. There's the Romans 12, mourn with those who mourn. Remember that as you cope with the pain, don't simply try to numb it. Acknowledge it is a perception of life, of love. My challenge to you is to trust a God who can redeem what now seems unredeemable. 10 days before the shooting on this campus, Christians around the world remember the darkest day of all human history, the day in which evil human beings violently rose up against God's own Son and murdered the only true innocent human being who has ever lived. We remember that day not as Dark Friday, Tragic Friday, Disaster Friday, rather Good Friday. That awful day led to the salvation of the world and also led to Easter. Church, I want to encourage you, you know, as we talked about last time, the opportunity that we have to really be the church and to remember that God is redeeming this and that he hasn't forsaken us. In the book that I mentioned from Philip Yancey is Where is God When It Hurts? And it's an outstanding book. You may want to take a look at it. Remember that we love and we care because we feel connected to people. When the Twin Towers came down in 9/11, think about how everybody rallied. Those weren't just people dying. those were our brothers and sisters dying in the Twin Towers. That's what we felt. It felt like family members. As I travel around the world now, I look at the suffering that I see happening right now in Haiti and in Africa, and I think, it hurts so badly. Those aren't just people. They're not just numbers. They're not just statistics. They're folks I love. And so I'm going to challenge the church to recognize the fact that, you know, we're sort of all on this giant satellite, this big ball called Earth. And in terms of what God would like us to do, he wants us to have compassion and care for those who are sick and weak and suffering and hurting and vulnerable and those who need him. So my challenge to you again, church, is just love people, love God, do the best you can to tie those two together and be the church. We love you. Thanks. Bye.